Blog Talk Radio.
Greetings, and welcome to Quantum Healing with Candace. I am your host, Candace Craw Goldman. This program was created to assist humans in this rapidly changing world, and its foundation is based upon the late, great Dolores Cannon's work. So thank you, Dolores, for continuing to be here with us. And also thanks to Greg Prescott and Michelle Walling at n5d.com for making this show possible. And this beautiful flute music playing in the background, which I'm hoping to get maybe a little better, better heard by you all, is courtesy of our dear friend and supporter of the show, Latita Teresa. And the title is Africanique. With humanity's new understanding and acceptance of the quantum world and the role that consciousness plays in shaping both our individual and collective reality, we have plenty of subject material. I am a full-time practitioner of Dolores' hypnosis method and had the honor and privilege of working with and alongside of her for several years. You can find out more about my practice at newearthjourney.com. And before we get started tonight, for those of you looking for a practitioner of Dolores' method, you may find these wonderful people at DoloresCannon.com. That's DoloresCannon.com. Also, if you would like to participate live on tonight's show, please call in the U.S. 646-716-8890. That's 646-716-8890, and we'll try to answer as many calls as possible. Tonight is December 4th, 2015, and I'm very excited about this evening's show, about as excited as any show that I've ever done, actually. I'm welcoming not only one, but two very special women to talk about Dolores Cannon tonight. Marilyn Dyke is a wonderful friend and a QHHT colleague who lives in Vancouver, Canada. I've had the great fortune to have worked with her in person, and I'm honored to call Marilyn my personal friend. I've known her for many years. She was and is a fine voice, not only of wisdom, but of integrity in our shared group, which is Dolores Cannon's original worldwide support forum for practitioners of her method of quantum healing. Marilyn's lifelong curiosity compelled her to explore many different subjects. She found that information that couldn't be explained in the usual manner was much more interesting than other material. Unusual ideas and theories piqued her interest. And through this search for knowledge, she explored the unexplained, and along the way, she took an interest and practiced different healing modalities, including herbal medicine, flower essences, crystals, and Reiki. And when she discovered Dolores Cannon's book, Convoluted Universe Book 2, in 2004, she knew she had finally found an author who was receiving answers to many of her questions. It was her interest in healing that convinced her to take Dolores Cannon's Past Life Regression Level 1 class in 2009. And she continued her studies with Dolores and became a Level 3 practitioner in 2013. Hi, Marilyn. Stand by while I introduce Tamira. Tamira McGillivray, I think is better pronounced, is a professional astrologer and symbolist. And I don't even know what a symbolist is. Tamira, you're going to have to let me know, who uses a variety of energy techniques to help her clients uncover their potential and interact with the universe in a way that manifests their highest good in this life and place. She holds a BA in East-West traditions and ancient religions and astrology. She's a yoga teacher, a meditation coach, a Reiki master. She studied with Dolores Cannon as a QHHT practitioner, and she is certified level 2. She is a professional astrologer. She's also a teacher and board member of Kepler College and the past president of the local San Diego chapter of the National Council of Geocosmic Research. That's pretty interesting, too. I don't even know what that is. She'll have to let us know. She writes a monthly astro column for an online Canadian magazine, and she's the owner of Silver Disc Consulting, which is dedicated to connecting ancient wisdom to the modern world through speaking engagements, workshops, one-on-one consultations, and also a weekly blog. As a lifelong learner and teacher, she opens up new perspectives for herself and others through her work with a variety of energy techniques. Marilyn and Tamira and I will be taking an in-depth look at QHHT founder, author, and teacher Dolores Cannon's astrology chart. Tamira has discovered some very rare and unique connections between Dolores' chart and another very well-known figure that may help us to understand the very big and real topics of time and timelessness. So without further ado, I want to welcome both Marilyn and Tamira to the show. Welcome, ladies, to the show.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
I'm so excited to have you here. I'm also so excited that our Skype connection is working. Yay, all of you people out there who put the white pyramid of light around the technology to make this happen. Marilyn, I'd like to start out by asking you, how did you and Tamira meet, and how long have you been friends?
Well, I think we've been friends about 20 years, and really, Tamira and I met when I was first really seriously looking into spirituality, metaphysics. And I remember I was in a bookstore, and she was one of the people there who was doing classes and but also helping out. I think it was a Saturday. And so she literally followed me around and was talking about, I don't know, wolves, the different colors of wolves, I don't know. But anyway, she literally followed me around. And then finally, we talked some more and found out she was teaching some classes I was interested in. And then I took some classes. We worked together a lot with Reiki and have just been, you know, she is my rock, my go-to person for information, and is also a great motivator for me. And I wouldn't want to be in this life, as I said before, without Tamira. I think that was probably one of the points that, you know, sticking points I made. I had to be here with Tamira. She's
oh,
a love
sweet.
And yeah, just I'm so pleased to have her as a friend.
As am I, Marilyn. That's a very sweet introduction of our friendship. Yes, we've been friends forever and have done many, many things together, including our QHHT training. We did that together even. Marilyn insisted that we did it together.
Now, where did you all take that class?
That was in Fayetteville.
Yes, it was.
So you and both traveled in.
We did, yeah.
I went down for a visit to San Diego, and then I think we met in Dallas, and then we traveled over to Fayetteville, didn't we? Yeah,
that's
and then
correct.
To your place, yeah, and we practiced.
Yeah.
Now, ladies, I have to ask you this: was that in the summer? Was that a summertime class?
Yeah, I think so. Yep.
You know,
April.
Oh.
Okay. I was there for the summertime classes, but I don't think it was April, but okay. Well, anyway, I'm so happy to have you both here.
I think you were, Candace.
Really?
I don't remember you, but I remember Dolores at the end of the class said, now listen, we don't hang you up to dry. Remember, she used to say that.
Yeah.
And she says, we've got this, you know, this person has set up this whole forum and where you can ask questions. Yeah, that was the old Yahoo forum.
And
you were there at the back of the class. You might not have been there for the whole class.
She didn't let me stay for the whole class that quickly. I had to prove my, I had to have a year or two to prove myself. But thank you for that lovely memory. And Tamara and Marilyn and I are part of this amazing worldwide community of other practitioners, and we've been sharing, you know, hundreds, if not thousands, of stories and concepts and ideas now for 7 years.
Yeah, it's good. Yeah, it would be 7 years.
Yeah, it's been quite a while. Well, let's just jump right into all of this, shall we? You know, the first thing I'd like to ask is, you know, all I know, Marilyn, is you said, how about we do a show like this? So how did the idea come to you?
I think because this is years ago, I got Dolores's, somebody on the forum, I think, actually posted Dolores's birth information. And I looked up her chart and I thought, oh, well, that's interesting, you know. And then, but I'm not for sure it was the right information. And then recently I looked again and I thought, holy cow, she's an eighth house sun sign. Isn't that, because I'm an eighth house sun sign. And then I started, you know, I was talking a little bit to Tamara on that. And then you asked me if I'd like to be on. And I don't know, you know, I was looking for ideas that would be interesting. And then maybe it was Dolores, but for whatever reason, I thought, wow, wouldn't it be fun to have Tamara on talking about Dolores's chart? And then that's when we got your birth information, and I said to Tamara, and I think I said to you too, wouldn't it be a hoot if Candace had an eighth house sun sign? And there you are.
You know, I need to ask that. I know that Tamara wasn't quite ready to talk about this quite yet, but, how many sun signs are there? I mean, is the odds really, really high for that then?
12, and I don't know what the odds are. Maybe Tamara can tell us.
Okay, so we have to kind of step back just a little tiny bit to be able to talk about the houses, because that's kind of where you get into more advanced. So what we need to know, first of all, is that when we're looking at an astrology chart, we're looking at it on a 2D piece of paper, or like it's a 2D piece of paper. You've got this print on it, and you've flattened out the night sky on this piece of paper. And astrology is a symbolic language. So when you were talking about me being able to read and interpret symbols and symbology, that's really what we're doing. It's like, whether you're looking at the mandala of the chart or whether you're looking at dream, you know, interpretation, it's all a symbolic interpretation. So the chart itself is like taking a snapshot of the sky at the moment of the person's birth and putting it out on this piece of paper so that we can symbolically glean information about ourselves. You know, really for further growth. We want to look at this. It's nice to have all this information, but what do you do with it? Well, there's skilled and unskilled behavior. So as you are symbolically interpreting the information, getting deeper into aspects of your psyche, you can then look at skilled and unskilled behavior and hopefully bring that into your day-to-day existence and work with that. So looking at the moment of your birth, the sign on the horizon is called your rising sign, your ascendant sign. So that's like if you were looking at the horizon, there's obviously this big mathematical calculation that happens, but we'll say, you know, you're standing out there, you're looking out the window at the moment of your birth, and this sign is on there. And the sign is the script. It's planets are utilizing as their script, how they're functioning. So, you know, you have an actor and this actor's given this script and they have to try to act out their part with this script. And the script tells us all kinds of things about behaviors that are going to come up with, you know, with each of the planets. So then we divide it into all of these houses. We now have this starting point where we can do 12 houses, and the 12 houses represent different areas of our life. And what you guys are talking about is the eighth house. And that is the house of mysteries. It's actually the house of death as well, and some say rebirth. So it's exactly what you're doing in QHHT. You're looking at, you're going sort of between the veil, looking at punching a hole in time, and going back into lives and gleaning information from those lives, looking at death, and you know, interpreting that and symbolically gaining information that helps you live a better life. So that having prominent planets, not just the sun sign, but also the moon sign. Dolores actually has had both of her sun and the moon sign of the day of her birth. You know, this day that she had they were both in Aries. So they were both utilizing the Aries script, which we'll talk about in a minute. But they were both in the eighth house of mysteries.
And I don't know if I'm getting off topic here right away, but I have a question about her moon, because it's 0 degrees. It's right on the house. So she could have very easily been a Pisces moon. And I'm just, you know, knowing her a little bit that I know her, and Candace would probably be able to add a lot more. I wonder what, you know, how she would have been different as a Pisces moon.
Well, it would have been very different, actually. And I did, because, you know, because we don't have her time on a birth certificate. Her time is from memory. And it's actually on the Astro Data Bank on astro.com, where I confirmed time, because you had found this birth time on, I think, on one of the forums, and I wanted to make sure that we did have the right birth time. And it is the one that's listed there that Dolores has given somebody from memory. So it's like her mother remembered that, you know, the time, or an aunt remembered the time, and this is the time that we've gone with. And so I did move her time back and forth to see if that moon would switch. But that whole day, it is an Aries moon. So we know that no matter what, even if we move the chart to, 2:30 or 1:30 or, you know, different times, that we're still getting this really strong, powerful Aries moon. And I think that Dolores had to have the sun and the moon both in Aries to be able to do the work that she did. I think if it was a Pisces moon, maybe she wouldn't have been as focused. Yeah. Definitely, yeah. You know, the Aries moon and the Aries sun really tells us that she was a pioneer in her field. That's, you know, it's a cardinal fire sign. Aries, and it's very much about, being the groundbreaker, being the one leading the pack, and that's exactly what she did. So I think that's why she had to have both the sun and the moon in Aries.
Yeah. Okay. Well, it's good to know that she's that solid in her sign. Good.
Yep. For sure. And zero, actually, that's a really good point too, is that she has a 0 degree. Aries moon. So, and this is like the very beginning of all the signs. Aries is the first sign in the zodiac. It's the sign of spring. It's the first one starting the pack. It's like the warrior that rushes to the battlefield and starts cutting heads off and, you know, doing their duty to forge ahead and win the battle. Without thinking, you know, they just jump in both feet and, you know, what happens. And at zero degrees, it's like, I don't know if you know the tarot cards, but you could utilize the Fool card as a 0 degree Aries moon. It's like, you know, when they just step off that cliff, just knowing they're going to be okay, just knowing that there's going to be something there to catch them. They have to have that fearlessness of just jumping into the thick of it and knowing they'll be okay. And that's what she did.
Well, if there is any way of describing Dolores Cannon, it is fearless. You bet.
Fearless, yeah.
I second that.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, so that's the first thing that jumps out. And the thing about you have a 8th house, packed 8th house, and Candace has planets in the 8th house, and we've looked at other charts that have planets in the 8th house. It doesn't mean that you have to have a whole bunch of planets in the 8th house to do QHHT for sure. But what it does mean is that there is some sort of thread, some sort of connection between the work that you're doing and this 8th house, it makes sense. You know, it is the house of mysteries. It's the house of death. So, you know, it does make sense. But to really be able to give that signature, you know, I'd have to look at, you know, a couple of hundred charts to know for sure if the majority of QHHT practitioners actually have eighth house, you know, have the eighth house planets.
Well, to me, it made sense because of the curiosity.
Yes.
The will dig deep, you know, and yeah, that yeah. I see myself and definitely Dolores. I mean, you know, the master questioner. She mm-hmm. just has more curiosity than anybody else I ever know, you know.
And that's really, Aries has that sense of curiosity. That's what drives them forward. That's what takes them to the head of the pack to forge ahead, is that they have this intense curiosity and they have the fire, the passion to follow the quest.
Yeah. And the fearlessness, like you said, and you know, Aries people are so much fun to be around, aren't they?
Yeah, absolutely.
Something new to do. There is never a moment when they can't find something fun to do. So, yeah.
Absolutely. And I know that Candace had a question about the connection to the female goddess that Dolores also had. You know, so where do our connections to our feminine and our masculine come into the chart? Now, she has a very heavy masculine signature with this stellium. She's got what's called a stellium in the 8th house, which means that there's 3 planets in the 8th house in Aries, and her north node is there as well. We'll talk about the nodes in a minute. So she has this real masculinity, which probably, you know, in her time period, like knowing when she was born and, you know, the sort of the male being dominant at that time, that if you were a woman and you were doing groundbreaking work, you certainly had to be strong. And that's where she got her strength from, and that masculine energy that made her fit in to, you know, to the sort of masculine era. But Dolores has a very, very beautiful Venus in her chart. Her Venus is in Pisces. And for astrologers, anybody who's an astrologer out there, her Venus is exalted. When a planet is exalted, she actually has several exalted planets. You know, we shouldn't be surprised. She has several exalted planets. An exalted planet is when it is in a position of power, but it's a special kind of power. When a planet is in rulership, when it's ruling its own sign, when it's really powerful that way, it can be a ruler. It can be a nice ruler. You know, we have nice rulers and we also have dictators. You know, it can be like the bad boy, you know, cutting heads off and putting their feet up on their desk and drinking beer and, you know, being badly behaved. But when they're exalted, it's like a king is visiting another country. He's still a king. You know, he still has that prominence of a king, and he's got all of his people around him doing all the things they need to do, and he's got his soldiers with him making sure he's okay. But he's in somebody else's kingdom, so he's actually going to be better behaved. So exalted planets they say classically that they are better behaved than and stronger in most cases than planets that are in rulership. So her Venus was exalted, and that is very, very ultra feminine. Really would give her that connection to the goddess. It's also in her seventh house, and the seventh house is about our relationship. It's our house of mirrors is really what I like to call it. It's where we surround ourselves with people that mirror back to us this energy that we're trying to learn, this energy that we're trying to embrace in ourselves. So she would surround herself with, you know, many goddesses, which, you know, you could see in her classes. She had many goddesses that would come to her class. And this would be her mirror in how she would grow and understand her own femininity and embrace that. So I just thought that was really interesting when you had asked about her masculine, feminine energy and how that might show up.
That is interesting, because her presentation was, you know, she was an imposing woman. She was not very delicate at all. She would walk into a room and just take command. She wasn't small either. You know, physically she wasn't small, and her voice was deep. And you know, again, she wasn't delicate. But how interesting is that? There's the play, and then the connection with the divine feminine, which we all know is what's, you know, coming back into our world right now and into our time.
But I would like to mention here her hands. Have you ever looked at her hands? And she used them, you know, you could see them. She had the most beautiful hands, very delicate fingers. They always captured my attention.
Yes.
And I was watching her.
Yes.
And I wonder if somehow that has something to do with it. You know, and that's how her beauty in one physical way really shone through.
Gosh, Marilyn, what a beautiful observation. I've never heard anyone actually say that out loud, even though I've noticed it myself. I mean, some of the most compelling photographs of Dolores and her most compelling gestures are when she would bring her hands to her face.
Yeah, yeah. And I don't know. I notice hands. I don't know why, but I do. I don't know if Tamara does, but I've always noticed that she's got a person who has a thin fingertips is a very sensitive person. This is how you read. I don't know much about reading hands, but this is the one thing I know that notes a very person who's very sensitive. So even though she always said she wasn't psychic or, you know, anything like that, I believe that maybe she was receiving more information than what she's telling us.
You bet.
Yes, and actually talking about her Venus could bring us to her Mercury. The one thing that I always noticed about Dolores was, you know, when she was doing the regression work, that beautiful, soft, melodic voice that she used. Well, her Mercury is how we communicate, not what we communicate, but how the tool that we have to communicate, which, you know, in one of those tools is our voice, another one would be writing, that kind of thing, was in Taurus. And Taurus is ruled by this beautiful, exalted Venus that she has. So that, to me, I kind of made that connection to her voice with this beautiful Venus.
Yeah, that's so true. Wow, that's a good one, Tam. I didn't even notice that, but on that one.
Okay.
I'm here, Tam.
Did we lose Tam?
Oh, no, sorry. Okay. I was muted.
Oh, that's
so. So the chart helps us unfold information about ourselves to allow us to kind of dig a little deeper. Like, why do we tick this way? How do we tick this way? We can't use it as an excuse, because, you know, skilled, unskilled behavior, there is no excuse for unskilled behavior. It happens. We all have unskilled behavior from time to time. But once you recognize, like, what the skill could be, then you can tap into that a little more frequently. So these exalted planets that she had, she had a couple other planets that were also exalted, they helped her be skilled, because the exalted planets are a little easier to work with, like her Venus. You know how Venus is one of those planets that is a part of our physical body in the sense of magnetizing ourselves. So, you know, when you meet those people and they have that magnetic quality and you're like, oh, you know, you really like, you want to be around them, or you're attracted to them, and you know they're special in some way, because, I mean, we're all special, but it's just in how we magnetize our physical feature of our self. So it's the Mars is how we go out and get things that we need. It's that part of it's the push pull of the magnetization. She had a very powerful Mars. Her Mars was in Leo, which is ruled by the Sun. Very, very powerful. And this beautiful, soft Venus that was in Pisces, and this push pull of these two energetic sides of her nature on how she went out and got what she wanted and how she would draw towards herself what she needed. So very beautiful. So I guess we'll just continue along with her chart here on some of the things that I noticed about her. I've talked about her having this exalted planet. Her Sun in Aries was also exalted. So it also has had this sort of special quality that she would be able to tap into. Obviously, you know, we're not born skilled. These are skills that we have to grow with and learn how to utilize. But her Sun, the spirit, was very, very powerful in her chart as well as her exalted Jupiter. Jupiter is a really beautiful planet when it's functioning well, you know, when it's skilled. Her Jupiter was in Cancer, and Jupiter is about opportunities and growth and wisdom. Hers was very powerful. It sat with a very powerful player that we're going to talk about a lot with Dolores, because I think it was a very integral part of her personality. And her Jupiter sat with her Pluto. And I think we've all probably heard the word Pluto. And I think if you haven't, if you have heard the word Pluto, then you kind of shake a little bit. You're like, oh, do we need to go there? Do we need to talk about Pluto? Pluto has this beautiful side to it as well as this really difficult side. But her exalted Jupiter sat with this Pluto and you know, would help and support this Pluto considerably. Her Mars was in Leo. That was another beautiful part of her chart. And we look at what's called a dispositor tree. It takes all of the parts of the psyche, and it looks at how they support each other and whether they support each other. Sometimes the psyche is well supported. Sometimes it struggles a little bit with, you know, with these weird loops that it's got to go through, and it has to kind of ask every aspect of the person's psyche before it moves forward and does things. And sometimes it has these dictators running it that are just running the show and creating havoc. In her particular case, she had this beautiful mutual reception. And a mutual reception is when two planets are in each other's sign and they support each other. And her whole chart was supported by her Mars, her ability to go out and get what she needed and do what she needed to do, action things she needed to action, and this Sun. And remember that the Sun is, now we'll get a little bit into the QHHT stuff as to how her chart fits so well in the work that she did. The Sun is, it's our solar energy. It's connected to the greater self, to the greater being, to the observer self. So this part of herself, of Dolores, why she was so good at what she did and did so well, you know, with what she did in the business and the teaching that she did, was because, I believe, of this Mars Sun connection, of this mutual reception that they had, the support they had for each other. So when she would become, and the Sun is also our consciousness, by the way, the moon is our subconscious and the Sun is our conscious. behavior. So this is part of what she did, bringing the conscious awareness into this moment in time, into a functioning part of the person that she was working with to be doing the healing. So I thought this was a really significant foundational energy that she carried in her chart that really explained the work that she did. And I think that was another reason, Marilyn, why her moon was also in Aries, because it, you know, the subconscious, it's bringing the subconscious into the conscious, you know, like having that moment of becoming conscious of what the subconscious is doing and whether it is supporting us or whether it's holding us back from things that we're trying to accomplish in this life.
Okay, well, I agree with you, and I look at that and I think, you know, subconscious, conscious mind, or conscious mind and, yeah, and the subconscious are in balance when
they
I look
are.
At
it. Yeah. Yeah. And then she has this really, I talked a little bit about the stellium, about this Uranus. Well, the stellium, it's the sun, Uranus, and the moon that are all in Aries. And it's called a stellium. It's like a little pack of energy that is all like focused on one thing. And of course, it's the eighth house. It's the mysteries that she was focused on. But the Uranus, the planet itself, is about our higher mental capacity. It's our observer self. It's our genius. The Mercury is our lower mind, and the Uranus is our higher mind. And I thought, wow, how apropos is her sun conjunct this Uranus in the eighth house? Because that's exactly where she took this. It's bringing the observer self, bringing the genius aspect of ourself into our conscious mind to be able to have a conversation.
Well, not only that, I mean, the woman had a mind like a steel trap.
Yes.
You know, I would love to be able to bring up details of
yes.
sessions that she could, you know, she just rattle on. I think she could go on for hours. True, Candace?
She really could. I have this particular memory where somebody was asking her, and I don't even remember what the question was, because if the question didn't matter, it was the way she answered the question that mattered. Somebody asked a very detailed question about something, and Dolores stopped for a moment, and she literally said something along the lines of, the answer to that question is in Convoluted Universe, page one, you know, page 193 or something like that. I mean, she actually pulled out a page number of where somebody should go. And maybe it was because she'd referenced it before or something, but it was just astonishing to me. She could just do that. And she did it all the time. I mean, she just rattled that off all the time. And what was so interesting to me too, was that she would do this sort of presentation of an encyclopedic mind. She would do that on stage. And yet when you were with her in a casual situation, you know, walking to and from class or having a bite to eat or whatever, she wasn't like that. She kind of, she talked about the weather. You know, she talked about food. It was just she's a very interesting woman in that way.
Actually, that was something that you had mentioned to me before, too. So I wanted to see where that was in the chart. And I really believe that that was the higher mind and the lower mind working. When she was on stage, that was the higher mind, the Uranus, that would stream information to her. And when you were with her in person and you were having lunch or going for a coffee, that was the lower mind. That's the Mercury. The Mercury was in Taurus. Taurus loves food. It loves, you know, to just talk about everyday things. It's a very down-to-earth, you know, aspect to having a Mercury. And also, it's kind of slows everything down. So the fast pace of the Aries gets slowed down into this really more methodical thinking.
Well, that brings to mind when we were doing the level three, Candace, you remember, I mean, this just shocked me because I'd never been in a small group with Dolores before. But I mean, not only was she, you know, like as you know, the higher mind and the lower mind, you could, she could flip back and forth. And she was, it was like she was constantly running both, I would think, because and, you know, she, not only was she trying to teach us and critique our videos and whatnot, but she was also worried about, well, it, are you too warm? Are you too cold? What are the snacks like? Have you got enough, you know? Are you sure you're okay? You know, she was so concerned about us.
Yeah, that's the Venus talking. Yeah.
Oh, the Venus. Okay, yeah. So she could just out of the blue, she'd be, her mind would be off into just very everyday mundane matters concerning whether we were all feeling okay or whatever. It was quite interesting to see her like that.
Mm-hmm. So just kind of diving a little bit deeper into her chart again here. So she's, I mentioned briefly about the North Node also in this, included in this eighth house. It's in this helium. It's actually 1 degree conjunct this Uranus. And the North Node is pointing us towards growth. It's where we're trying to get to. Where we're coming from, there's another point in the chart directly across, obviously, from that, which is called the South Node. The South Node is where we come from, and some say that's our past lives, and that's how we connect to our past life information is through the South Node. So we can see that growth into this new way of being, this new healing technique, this new way of talking to our higher mind, was something that she was completely focused on. So this North Node, which is a very integral part in our chart, was part of this stellium. So that was pretty exciting when I saw that there as well.
Yeah. Also, it's retrograde. So does that have any...
They're all retrograde.
Oh,
all nodes.
Okay.
Yeah, the nodes move. The nodes actually move the opposite direction to the planets. So,
right.
But there's... Yeah. They're very slow moving, though. They take 30 years to move around the chart. And she was a very nodal person in the sense that when I looked at future events that happened in Dolores's life, the nodes were often involved. So this node being so integral in this eighth house and in this stellium, the nodes were very active. So, you know, the karmic aspect of it, you know, dealing with karma, dealing with people getting caught up in karma, dealing with growth, you know, forward and letting go of past. This was very, very much a part of her life. And it shows very, very much in her chart as being very integral to that experience.
Well, isn't that interesting? Because, of course, you know, until the latter part of her teaching and life, I mean, she was known for Dolores Cannon's method of past life regression. And she talked about karma, you know, all the way up until the end. Of course, towards the end, she was talking about the fact that, you know, much of karma and the concept of karma is being released and everything. But how interesting is that? I mean, she made her whole life's work about that.
Yeah, I thought it was incredibly fascinating that it was so interesting. Sometimes the nodes are really active in somebody's chart and sometimes they're not. And for her, they're embedded in everything she did. It was, you know, revolving around these nodes. The other thing was the Pluto. I wanted to talk a little bit about her Pluto because it is it kind of leads into other things that we're going to talk about. Pluto is it's a very collective planet. It's very, very slow moving. So lots of us, you know, share the same, it has all of our, you know, Pluto will have the same script for, you know, a whole generation. It's a generational planet. Where it shows up in the chart is individual, obviously, and the connections it makes to other planets is very personal. So the Pluto itself represents power and control. It represents the ego. And I know one thought that you had was, how was she able to separate herself from, negativity or, all the things that she was experienced in the work that she did, because there would be depression and darkness that would, that people, she's trying to deal with other people. And how do you deal with all that? I really feel that her Pluto being so connected to this really, really fantastic Jupiter certainly helped her with the Jupiter's exalted, remember? So he has a special strength that he carries. And so it's like, how do you separate yourself from ego, like from becoming egotistical or having ego, kind of hanging over your head? The thing about Pluto is that you have to let go of your ego in order to gain true power. That's the deal. So as soon as you can let go of your ego, then the whole world opens up to you. And the work that she did, obviously you have to let go of the ego just in the work, let alone all of the accolades that come with that. All the people that want to meet you and want to, be close to you and want to learn from you and all that kind of stuff. But that aside, just the work that she did, the method that she developed is letting go of the ego. So this Pluto was so integral in her learning about letting go of the ego, that when you let go of ego, when you let go of control, then you have all the control you desire, because we know that it's in your reaction to your environment. You can't change your environment. All you can change is how you interact with your environment, how you deal with your environment, and how you behave, within that environment for yourself. You can't change the actual environment that you're in. So I just thought, and also as we develop some of this storyline, as we start taking this a little bit further and looking at her chart with Nostradamus's chart, we're going to see that this Pluto is very, very integral to her relationship with him as well.
Hmm.
Yeah.
When she would teach and she would talk about the relationship that a facilitator would create with a client, she was masterful at that moment of really exemplifying that the story and the energy and the spotlight, of course, should always be on the client. And there are, some who would take the class that would need to be reminded of that, maybe a little bit more often. But when Dolores herself, when she was the facilitator, all attention, all focus, all energy was on the client. And she completely set her ego aside doing that work. And, think about the thousands and thousands and thousands of sessions that she did that way over all of these years, where she really did. She had to set that aside to sit in those sessions and allow that information to come forth like that. So that's really interesting.
It is. It is very, very interesting. And it was something I wanted to, kind of dive into and look at in her chart. Her Pluto is actually in an exact opposition. So it stands exactly across from the Saturn in her chart. This is not an easy, I'm not talking easy peasy. This, letting go of the ego. It wasn't like she snapped her fingers. Oh, I've got an exalted planet and all of it. This is work that she had to do on herself in order to get to that state. And this Saturn is about boundaries and limitations, structure. And how she has this very structured way of doing the work that she did. And it's in that structure that she embraced, because her Saturn is actually very powerful. It's in a really powerful sign. It's in its rulership, which means that it could be a dictator, right? Or it could be a nice ruler, like a great king, or it could be a troublesome king. And across from this Pluto, holy mackerel, that could be a really, really tough, tough thing to deal with. But she was able to take this energy signature, which is very stressful, to the skilled level, and utilize it, like you said, thousands and thousands of times where she was able to take this to the next level. And I think that, you know, the support of the chart, the support of the Venus in the seventh house, the support of having this really strong sun and powerful moon, you know, and the eighth house things that she had would have supported that. But it didn't mean that, that Dolores didn't do work. Dolores had to work very hard in order to be skilled with this kind of energy.
I think she really did work hard. You know, when you think about it, and this may be kind of reaching back to something that you've already said, but about how she made things happen. I mean, this was the woman who, you know, wrote these books and shopped them around, at, you know, to publishers and then got pink slip after pink slip after pink slip. I mean, she was so determined and so focused and so strong. And then, you know, and then just flat created her own publishing house to publish her own books, you know, so she just, she was not going to be denied.
I think that describes her perfectly, because she worked, I got to say, 24/7 her entire life on this project. And what was the project? The project was really ultimately the shift in consciousness. I mean, you know, every moment, even while watching TV, she'd be reading through transcripts and working constantly.
And she had such energy, didn't she, Marilyn? I mean, there, you know, last couple of years when we would be working with her, you know, we'd have class after class and days after days of classes, and we would have dinner, and then the rest of us people who were, you know, decades younger than her would go fall asleep in our beds, and she'd go up to her hotel room and start writing. I mean, it was just astonishing, and she did that all the way up till the end.
Yeah, and I can see what Tamara's saying about with the Saturn too being in Capricorn. She would be like a bulldog. She would not let go. If there was something that needed to be done or said or whatever it was, she would go there. Even if she didn't emotionally herself, you know, she felt sometimes she may have felt a little hesitant to do that, but she would do it nonetheless in order to further the, what I call the project, the you know, in the bigger picture.
Yeah, absolutely. And you can, like I said, it's not that it's easy. This opposition is actually quite difficult. And it is tied into this really powerful sun that she had. And in astrology, we call it a T-square. And it doesn't sound pretty, does it? It's not like some real foo-foo name. It's like, you know, planets that are struggling to work together in order to better a cause, in order to better the person, in order to get a job done. And that's exactly what they're, you know, what they do. So sometimes the harder things we see in our chart actually are the things that bring the biggest gift, because once we can master them, once we can become skilled in those energies, we can do great things. And we know that Dolores did. So we're grateful that she did all that work on herself.
Yeah, when you look at it, yeah, maybe it wasn't easy, but boy, she had what she needed, didn't she?
Yeah. And, you know, that comes to, I know that you talk about detail, and we're like, where's the detail in her chart? Actually, her ascendant, what was on the horizon at the moment of her birth, was Virgo. And this Virgo is, it's like, think about sand. It's mutable earth. So, you know, counting all those tiny grains of sand, keeping them all in order, you know, keeping everything organized. That was the ascendant. That was what was on her horizon. And that's what you saw, was this really incredibly organized person that was able to pull everything together, that was able to provide this, you know, the classes and teaching and do all those thousands and thousands of clients. And along with that was her Neptune. So, you know, this is a very collective planet. But what's so special about this Neptune is its position on the horizon. It sits on the horizon. And this is really what gave her, I'll say, the connection to the collective that was so, so powerful in her life. That's really where it comes from. The other thing about this Neptune is that it's relatively unaspected. It actually is only unaspected by what we call a quincunx, which is a very obscure connection to the chart, very, very little connection to the chart. Sometimes when we have these planets that have very little connection to, well, has no connection to the personal planets, like the personal aspect of the psyche that we function in the physical body with, it had no connection to that at all. And what we have to think about there is that it was untethered. So it really, her connection to the collective was untethered by her earthly body. And I think that, shows itself quite well in her life as well. Yeah, very, very interesting stuff. So we could move on to a little bit of her transit. I did want to talk a little tiny bit about some transit things. And when we look at a transit chart, it's really taking a point in time and it overlays the chart. And we look to see what's lit up. So it's always about the natal chart. Transits happen every day. Things happen every day that light everybody's charts up. But it's what lights your chart up, what lights Dolores's chart up. What happens is these planets, it's like your environment, your external environment is lighting something up inside. And then that's having some sort of consequence, good or bad, or, moving forward, that kind of thing. And she had some very significant ones. And again, I had talked about the nodal connections when she had big things happen in her life in 1968. What happened in 68? Oh, yes, she became involved in hypnosis in 1968. She actually had a nodal return. So these planets, once you're born, they continue, moving on their merry way. They go around the chart. Some whip around, the moon whips around every month. The sun whips around once a year, right? Your solar return is literally your birthday. And then you have planets like the nodes in Saturn that take 30 years to move around the chart, 30 years to return to their birth spot. And at the return of her nodes to their birth spot, to when, the moment of her birth, was when she became involved in how enlightening is that? How, like, the nodes are like, come on, we need to get moving in this direction. So they lit up her chart so that she would become engaged in this new thing that she was doing, this hypnosis. I thought that was absolutely fascinating. In 78, I have listed that in 79, she started exclusively working with past life therapy and regression work. In 78, the end of 1978, her Saturn, remember that planet of boundaries and limitations and structure? He's a good guy, as well as, he can throw some curveballs. But really what he's there to do is help you structure your life in order to accomplish the things you want to accomplish. Well, that dude went over her Neptune, that collective point that I was telling you about, the one that's kind of untethered and a little bit difficult to rein in. All of a sudden, this Saturn, this planet of a structure of creating boundaries around her, this collectiveness that was around her, this chaos, bringing it into a format that she could utilize and understand. Well, a year later, 6 months later, she starts working exclusively with past life therapy. One of the things that Saturn does when it hits that Neptune is it's like lighting a fire under someone's behind to say, get your butt in gear. Here's a goal. We need to make this goal. How are we going to accomplish it? It's a do or die almost in a person's life where they feel like they're really driven to accomplish something and they become almost frenzied in order to accomplish it. So I'm sure that year between 78 and 79, when she really went into exclusive past life therapy, she was going through this transition of, I need to change the work I'm doing. It needs to be deeper, and I need to bring that collective. For her, it was exploring the collective, really, this Neptune energy. And in 1986, we had another point. August of 86, the North Node transited her Sun, and this was when she expanded her investigations into the UFO field. I thought it was absolutely fascinating, because here's that Uranus again. Uranus can be like a lightning strike as well. You know, it's like the genius in us, right, that comes to surface. Here the node transits, you know, that eighth house and starts to spark her thoughts about UFO and doing studies in suspected UFO landings and such. So you can really see how, the nodes were very, very active in her life, and very significant, because as we move into the next topic, those nodes are going to show up again. So before I move into the next topic, which is about Dolores and Nostradamus, did you guys have any questions or thoughts about that?
I would say, right on at 86, when she went into the UFO information, I don't think she jumped in with both feet right away. But you can see how, I don't know, but I can picture it being like almost overnight, for going from, well, not too much interest to, boom, she was right into it.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a question here about, for you, Tamara, about,
sure,
before we go into the Nostradamus, is because I'm looking at the chart, the inner ring is her birth chart, and the outer is her death chart at the moment of her death. And I'm wondering, is it normal to have the house placement exactly the same as in the birth, or have I got something wrong?
No. So what you're looking at is the double ring is everything is based on the natal chart in our life. So all of the transits that happen, including our death, is based on our natal chart. So that's why it looks like it lines up.
Okay.
What you're really looking for is you're looking for the planetary connections. And we can see that there were some very, very significant.
Sun was exactly, really, 1 degree off her birth opposite, okay? So in the dash chart, it's 25 degrees.
Oh, yes, yeah, in opposition.
Yeah, in direct opposition. Does that happen normally?
Yes, so that happens to us every year. Every year our sun is in the opposite sign, so...
death?
Well, no, it doesn't happen very often in the death, actually. The only thing I was going to say about that is that it's when we have the least amount of energy. So when we have our solar return, which is our birthday, the sun returns to its place of birth, and it kind of gives us like that little spark. It feeds us. It gives us energy. It gives us solar energy to last us another year. When it's in the opposite position of its birth position, it's kind of like we're waning, like we don't have very much energy. It's like the sun is the farthest away from us that it could be. So that's when she had her death chart, was when she passed away, the sun was in the farthest exact spot. You were right. It's at 25 degrees Libra. Her sun is 24 degrees Aries. It's an exact opposition. And the life force would have been fairly weak at that moment. So that, that can be a contributing factor, absolutely. Also, if you look at it, the south, the nodes are in opposition as well. So the nodes are coming into an opposition of themselves, because they normally sit across from each other. Well, they always sit across from each other. And hers, of course, is conjunct that Uranus. So it's at 14 degrees Aries. And 14 degrees Libra, her south node and her north node. And in her death chart, the nodes are coming up to that. They're 18 degrees or four degrees away from their actual birth spot, which is extremely unusual. You see Uranus is there as well. So she's just about to have a Uranus return, which only happens once in our lifetime. And for us, it can happen anywhere between the ages of, let's say, 79 to 84-ish, you know, in that kind of ballpark. So, yeah. You know, so that happens once in our lifetime. It takes that long for Uranus to get all, you know, to get all the way back around to itself again. So you can see the lineup. Would you ever predict that this would be her, you know, a death chart? No. You wouldn't predict that because it's normally the death will show up in somebody else's. It shows up in your kids' charts and your students' charts. It shows up in another way. But in your own chart, when you see this, it's just like the stars aligned. And, you know, this was a moment. This was a moment that she was able to pass through. And she decided to take it. Also, in the death chart, there's so many connections. It's, you know, it's unbelievable. But also in the death chart, there is the Neptune is in opposition. So the birth Neptune is that 3 degrees Virgo, and the you know, the transiting the night sky Neptune is at 5 degrees Pisces. It's in opposite. It's right across, you know, from itself. Again. That Neptune is very integral to how she pulls in, how she connects to the collective itself. So it's in opposition. It's, you know, it was just this moment that lined up for her in the night sky. And she was able to transition at that moment and decided she wanted to.
Yeah, I think, and it was a choice because, from what I have been told by Julia, it was, you know, she had recovered. She was doing fine. And then, obviously, you know, this was in the plan and she decided to take it on some level other than conscious.
Yeah, and the Uranus itself, the transiting Uranus, the night sky Uranus, I just said was, you know, she was about to have a Uranus return. It's at 14 degrees Aries, 5 minutes. So we actually have like exact moments in time. And when we compare that to her north node, this nodal thing that I said, she's very connected to her node. She's very connected to, really, that's the project itself. In my opinion, that was the project, was that north node, was this whole lifetime of doing, of getting everyone to the level she got them to. And it's at 14 degrees 4 minutes. It was 1 minute. That is like a millisecond in star time. I mean, it's not, it's like a blip, you know. I mean, it's so close. It's unbelievable, really. So, you know, I mean, it's, that's why I was confirming what the birth time was, or what the death time was, because the chart is just so bang on to a moment in time where, you know, where she chose to leave. Where she chose to transition.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's very interesting. Okay.
Yeah. So should we move to Nostradamus?
Yes, please. I'm excited to find out about this part.
Okay. So, you know, when we... Now, let's start with a little bit of background, because maybe not everybody knows about Dolores and Nostradamus. Can you guys kind of fill us in with a little bit of detail?
Sure. Why don't we both do that, Marilyn? So I'll start by saying Dolores wrote 3 large volumes about Nostradamus. And what she basically did was she had a client who, of course, had a past life regression. And this client ended up being, in their past life, a student of Nostradamus. And in the explorations with this particular client as a student, so much of this student's life was you know, revolved around what I believe the client was a female, but it was a male student, a male life that she was experiencing that was the student of Nostradamus. And so much of the questions that, and you can just imagine this, Dolores asking these questions, she wanted to know so much about, you know, the teacher and the things that he was learning and everything. And I guess at some point, and it was a very pivotal moment, at some point during the regression, the client sort of said, you know, as the male student, well, why don't you just ask my teacher directly? And then Dolores started speaking with Nostradamus. And they began this amazing relationship, and with Dolores and her curiosity and all the questions that she would ask, he was, you know, the perfect foil for her because he was so interested in the occult and in the cosmos and in the mysteries of life and itself. But it became more and more interesting. So the books themselves are in general Dolores basically sitting there, and forgive me for if it sounds like I'm making light of it, because I'm really not. But she basically was kind of a stenographer. You know, she just wrote down what the quatrains that Nostradamus had penned, you know, hundreds of years ago, what they meant. She basically would go open the book and say, well, what did this one mean? And then Nostradamus would tell what, well, this is what I meant when I, you know, wrote that one. This was what this was all about. So when Dolores wrote about Nostradamus, and when she had been and has been called an expert on him, it wasn't because of any theories that she had or any deep thinking. She literally was talking to this man across time and space. And most interesting for me anyway, and I'm hoping we learn about this a little bit, was that this conversation continued through multiple people. I think it was at Marilyn, was it 12 different clients?
Yes, 12 different clients. Which has significance. I'm going to ask Tamara about later.
Yeah, 12, right? Okay, I'm buzzing. I'm buzzing as I'm saying that. Right, so she made this connection through time and space with Nostradamus as he was alive. So not as a spirit, not as a person, not as a character who'd gone through a life and death, not as a past life sort of thing, but the living Nostradamus. He was alive at this time. So if you can imagine the scene was something like this. Nostradamus, you know, back in the 15, whatever it was, I guess, 1540s, 1580s, something like that. He is sitting in his studio, in his office, and he is looking and meditating and putting himself into a trance, looking into a piece of shiny black obsidian rock. And he, in this way, somehow by looking into this rock, makes a connection with Dolores Cannon, who is in Huntsville, Arkansas, in her office with a client who's in trance. And they start to talk to each other. So Dolores is using a living person, a client in trance, laying on a bed. In, you know, was it the 1980s? I'm not sure when she was doing this, so the 1990s or maybe. She was talking to Nostradamus while he was looking at a shiny black rock, and they were speaking and having conversations across 12 different people and many, many months of talking.
And speaking through what I call real time.
Right. Like a telephone.
Yeah, it's like a telephone, exactly. Very much like your dream.
Yeah.
And he had such a, he had such a personality, which came through in, you know, how he was, you know, in comments he would make about her education, you know, because she didn't know Greek and Latin. And, you know, and then when he found out that she was a woman, well, he was just like, how can I work with a woman? Because women in his day were not educated.
I know.
I mean,
It's one of my favorite stories of all.
You cannot deny that this wasn't real time, you know, when the personality comes through like that. Is confirmation, but they work on not all of his quatrains, but she said, I've got a video up of Dolores, it's a fairly recent one of her talking about Nostradamus up on my website, and it's under Dolores Cannon Speaks, if anybody's interested, because there's a lot of detail there that I, you know, it's been a while since I've read the book. Now I forgot what I was going to say. But anyway, it was just that, about the different, mainly the quatrains that they worked on were the ones that were dealing with our time.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like he consciously knew that he was going to be connecting with someone to decipher these quatrains that had befuddled people for 400 years. And finally, they were going to be deciphered time when they were actually going to come to pass.
Right. It's just so amazing.
Yeah. It's just, I mean, it blows my mind.
I think the part that, and this is just a humorous aside, but the part that I find amazing is when Dolores tells the story, they kind of, I guess, were shutting down a session. You know, they'd been doing this hour after hour after hour after hour, this translation and dictation, and it was at the end of one of these sessions they were getting ready to shut down, and they were talking about, I believe it was medicine and doctors, and Dolores said something about a doctor that she went to and referenced the doctor being a female, and this is when Nostradamus said something like, what do you mean her, you know, it's a doctor, it must be a him. And that's when they started almost having a little argument. I just love this. If I could have been a fly on the wall. And Dolores says, well, you know, in our time, women are doctors and they're lawyers and they do, you know, they're physicists and they're anything that men can be. And that's when, you know, basically Nostradamus from back in his day says, get out. This isn't possible, which I find astonishing. You know, he's talking to a rock. A woman, you know, hundreds of years into the future. And this is believable to him. But the idea that it's a female person he's talking to really tests his believability factor.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, what Tamara had said earlier about Dolores's strong masculine presence in her chart, you can see she wasn't going to back down to him, you know.
Right.
Information and get that through, and she wasn't going to back down. And it's probably just the type of personality that that was needed to bring through this information as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So tell us, Tamara, what it was like to start investigating the connections between Dolores and Nostradamus.
I was actually really shocked when I laid his chart over Dolores's, and I'm like, oh my God, this can't be. How can this be? Because it was so powerful. Not only are they connected in with his birth chart, but also his death chart is very connected to her natal chart as well. So I was blown away because some of the connections, you know, an astrologer could say, oh, well, you know, that's generational and there's like a whole bunch of people are going to be born at that time that will have that same connection. But then when you start to dig a little bit deeper, there's a connection between their charts that is very intimate to Dolores that you would not find with, you know, with a generational group of people being born. So it really does show that they have this really, really deep, deep connection. The first connection I want to talk about is that there is this, so we talked about Dolores's Saturn and her Pluto being in opposition, and the Pluto being conjunct the Jupiter. So we've got this her having to learn about ego and setting aside ego and how she worked with power. And there's all these control issues, you know, that she had to work with. And that's one of the reasons why she set this stage, why she set the script that she set, because it makes people feel comfortable letting go and giving somebody else control. So we can see that. Well, we lay Nostradamus over top of her chart, and his Mars, that planet of action, the planet of going out and getting what you want, the physicality of ourselves, is in a direct connection of minutes. It's at the same degree as her Pluto. It's at 18 degrees with her Pluto. That combination is actually very volatile. It's something to control, that kind of intense energy. That's like a bomb going off. So here you've got this really, really intense connection. So not only do we have that connection, that we've got this Mars-Pluto, which lines up to that Saturn. Remember, the Saturn is the anchor. Well, if you look a little further, the Saturn is conjunct his Neptune. So Dolores's Saturn of boundaries and limitations is connected to Nostradamus's Neptune, which is about dissolving boundaries. It's about being a part of the collective where there are no boundaries. So this boundaryless connection is, how am I going to structure this conversation with Nostradamus and be able to punch a hole through time, Saturn is time, in order to connect with Nostradamus. This is how, this is the line, this is the power punch, this is the hole that was punched through time for her to be able to talk to him live. That's how I believe that line is activated in the chart. That's not the only thing that we've got that we're looking at, but it's just such a powerful, powerful signature between the two of them directly. And remember, they're born hundreds of years apart. So for this connection, you know, to come up so powerful like this is just bizarre. Then we can move to, okay, we've got this really collective connection. Now we can look at their Jupiters. Remember me saying that Jupiter is the planet of wisdom and growth and opportunity? Well, guess whose Jupiters are conjunct? He has the same exalted Jupiter as she has. They're conjunct. They're sitting side by side. So it's this deeper level of, they share some level of wisdom. They share this opportunity in order for his wisdom to come through to our time period and be interpreted by Dolores. She may have called herself a scribe, but she still had to decipher his language, because even though, you know, because he's speaking, you know, a different dialect of English, you know, so she's still going to have to interpret it to some point. Well, that's the Jupiter that's allowing her to connect to that innate wisdom that the two of them share in order to deliver the message.
Actually, he was really missed because he wanted someone to that would speak French.
Right.
French or Latin.
Right.
Yeah.
I was just going to say his native language was French. And oh my goodness.
Yeah.
Well, and funnily enough, there's actually two signatures in their charts together. So Dolores's Mars is in opposition to his Venus. So that's a little bit of a disconnect where, you know, where you could see him saying, oh, a woman, you know, oh my God, like, why do I have to speak with a woman? And also a woman in power, his Pluto is squared Dolores' moon. So there was a really powerful, again, remember, square is not a nice, pretty word. It's like difficult. So it's a difficulty they had to overcome, the feminine energy to the power, you know, to the masculine power. So they had to overcome that, and they did overcome it. They did, because remember, when we come up against a square, when we utilize that energy in a skilled way, great things come from it. And that's exactly what happened. Mm-hmm. Well, in support to that energy, that square was going on, that lunar energy, the moon, this powerful moon that Dolores had in Aries, we've already talked about, his north node is in a direct connection, a direct conjunction to this moon. That's where the personal thing comes in. You're not going to find that anywhere but with Dolores and Nostradamus. That's the mind blower. So then his north node, the direction he needed to go in, was to connect to Dolores's subconscious, which, you know, Dolores brought to her consciousness. She, her subconscious was not buried where she wouldn't be able to take this connection and move it to the next level. Dolores has this connection between her subconscious and her conscious. And that's where they took this information and brought it to us.
It's just so fascinating. Tamara, how did this, you know, I'm a baby when it comes to astrology. So I really, you know, there's so much that I don't understand. And quite frankly, some of it's still kind of going over my head, although you're doing a fabulous job explaining it. Some of it, you really are. Some of it is still, I'm learning. I need to have a couple lessons in this, but, but what is it, how is it that they magnetized or created the connection? Do you know what I'm saying?
Yes. Yes. So that to me is the Mars, Pluto, Saturn, Neptune. It's all in a line. It lines up in the chart. So it's literally a linear line in the chart. They are in line. His Mars to her Pluto to her Saturn to his Neptune. They're in a straight line, a linear line. That to me is the whole punch through time.
So that literally, when you say, you know, they're meeting, their connection, they're working
yep.
together, was written in the stars. It was written
yes.
in the stars
yes.
in that exact way.
Yes.
And how about this then? Like the timing that when they first discovered each other. And
yeah.
I mean, how does that all play in?
Well, I would love to have that exact time, and maybe that's something we could pursue, you know, and write about later, is that I want that exact time, because somehow I'm going to look at, because I can look at his chart and I can look at her chart and somehow try and bring that moment that happened,
yeah.
the window of opportunity that came for two of them to connect. But it really is, it's the nodes, the moon, that is such a personal connection. It's a connection through the soul, through, you know, the past and the future, because the nodes are where the past and the future come together. That's, you can't have one without the other. That's the thing about the nodes. They're always in opposition to each other. The past is always in opposition to the future. So this is where it all came together, through Dolores's moon.
Hmm.
Now, his moon, which is at 15 Scorpio, is in opposition to her Chiron. So his soul, his patterns and habits that he developed to function, because the moon is how we function in our day-to-day life. It's our subconscious. It was in an opposition to her Chiron, and Chiron is the wounded healer. It's about the wound we need to heal over lifetimes. It's the wound we carry lifetime after lifetime after lifetime until we get to the point where we're skilled enough to be able to heal it. So again, an opposition means that it's not an easy thing. It wasn't an easy thing for him to do this, but it was through his ability to connect to this rock, to this to the level of depth, because that rock took him into his subconscious, took him down into his subconscious in order to heal. What did he want to heal? He wanted people to actually get his message, because the message had been lost.
Yeah.
Dolores's Chiron is conjunct. It's conjunct her Mercury, her ability to communicate. So her Chiron and Mercury are dead center to this moon. It slices right up in between the two of them. So we know that the communication, the writing, the healing, this wasn't just for Dolores. Yeah. This was for Nostradamus. He needed this healing to happen. He was probably wrought with sadness that the world really did not get his message. And here he had opportunity to deliver the message again in modern times when the information was supposed to be actually coming, you know, to fruition. So this was a healing for both of them. This connection was so, it's just so, so powerful. It's unbelievable, as is the death chart. Nostradamus's death with Dolores Cannon's chart. Again, another very, very powerful, powerful thing. Now, I've talked about symbology, and there's one more thing I want to talk about here before we go any further with this. So there was a group of, a book written with all of these symbols, and each symbol represents a degree in the astrology chart. So every single degree has a symbol associated with it. They were done by Elsie Wheeler and Mark Edmund Jones. Mark Edmund Jones was a really, really famous, famous astrologer in the early 1900s. He was a really, really famous, very technical, well-known, incredible astrologer. He really made astrology come back to life in North America. So he met this Elsie Wheeler, who was a extraordinary clairvoyant. And actually, Elsie was in a wheelchair. So she came from a wealthy family, and her family sent her out to study spirituality because she was an incredible psychic, to develop her psychic skills. And she got involved in this group that
Okay, so can everyone hear me now? I'm going to go to the chat room and see if you all can hear me. Something about Skype just dropped us off. Can you all hear me? Yay, Alba says hi. Okay, so we're going to reconnect via telephone. And I see that we have Tamara right here.
Hello.
Hi, Tamara.
Hi.
I'm so glad you're there.
That was weird, hey? You just dropped us off there, and wow.
Yeah, I'm not sure why we have to jump through these technological hoops, but thank you all for remaining with us through these.
Yes.
Difficulties, and hopefully we can get Marilyn. Marilyn, I hope that you can give us a call and join us.
Yeah.
Join us again. But let's see. Quite frankly, I'm so distracted by getting us back online. I'm not exactly sure where we were. I can tell you that there was only about 20 or 30 seconds before I let you know that we were offline.
Okay.
So if
okay.
you could just back up that. We were talking
sure.
about Nostradamus. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay, so what I was talking about was that I was looking at the degrees of significance in the chart, and I used these symbols called Sabian symbols, and I was kind of talking about the origin of them. They were channeled by a woman in 1925 called Elsie Wheeler. And Mark Edmund Jones was a really famous astrologer at the time and wrote lots and lots of books on astrology. And he worked with her on these symbolic messages that kind of followed every degree around. Why that's so significant, why I needed to tell you that, is that the 18 degree Pluto, it's 18 and some, so we always take it up to 19. So we've got 19, we'll just go round numbers, 19 degrees Pluto for Dolores, 19 degrees Mars for Nostradamus. And where it really jumped out at me and was kind of shocking was when I looked at his death chart. His sun was at 19 degrees Cancer. His sun was conjunct his Mars, which of course is conjunct her Pluto, and it lines up that hole that they've got punched in between, you know, between the worlds, like this line of communication, this direct communication. It's not past life, it's they're talking direct. So his sun is conjunct this. So I'm like, well, what in the world does that symbol mean? Like, let's get some depth in this. Like, where's the Sabian symbols take us with this? Well, when I looked it up, I kind of fell off my chair. It's making levels of commitment to a person or a project. It's vows of allegiance. It's new ventures, and it's union. That's the meaning of that symbol of 19 degrees Cancer. I was blown away because really it gives us that level of understanding. What were these guys doing together? They had made a commitment to come together for this project. And it was a sacred vow that they took, expressions of loyalty. It was sanctified unity. So it just blew me away.
Oh my gosh.
I know. It just was so deep.
I am buzzing all over with that.
Yes.
So what you're saying is there was like some sort of soul contract here that
yes.
did.
Absolutely. No question in my mind. They had made a contract to each other. They made a commitment to each other that for this project, that not only would they bring the information to us, but from Nostradamus, but also that Dolores was here fulfilling her contract in taking us to the next level, in connecting us to our conscious mind, in developing this technique that allowed us to move through time, and realizing that we do have the ability to punch a hole through time, to talk to a live person, not just to a past life. That's what really blew me away, is that it is possible. And that's what they brought us.
That's just absolutely, absolutely amazing. So
phenomenal.
Actually, we're seeing MJ Allinger, our amazing researcher of the Dolores Cannon work. She's doing indexing for our incredible original support forum group. She has she's putting something here in the chat room. It's called The End and the Beginning, and Dolores's comment in this chapter, Dolores describes how she was chosen to work with Nostradamus and what his purpose for translating his quatrains were, and a look into the human caring part. And Dolores says, I've been wondering why he chose me to be the one to do this. Did I have any kind of an association with him in a past life? Mm-hmm. Nostradamus responds, not because of any karmic association. Dolores was most strategically located somehow on reference to, and then I'm not exactly sure. That's just so astonishing, so astonishing.
The stars literally lined up for them to be able to do what they did.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty phenomenal. Pretty phenomenal.
Wow.
So I had to make sure I was able to bring that to you guys so you guys could ponder that.
That's
you
just
know.
Astonishing.
Yeah.
And I know and You made some sort of comment that it was almost as if they were the same person.
Yeah. Well, that's the way it to me that it came across in the chart was that, you know, that she was him, that somehow they were connected on. It wasn't just two people connecting through time. That on some level she was talking to herself. That this connection was so much deeper, because it wasn't her in a past life. It was her talking to her actual self. It's like punching a hole in time. So the chart is so powerful in this signature. That's exactly where my mind went. Is somehow, you know, she is him, or they are one, And, you know, this thought of sanctified unity, there's some level of unity that's, you know, that has taken place here between the two of them.
That's just astonishing. You know, I had this, in March when I was in Arkansas, I was very close to where Dolores worked, where I was staying that night. And I had several dreams, five dreams in a row about Dolores. This was March of this year. And each one was incredibly powerful. But one dream was about and she literally took him by the hand, and they stood shoulder to shoulder, and they came up to me, and she said to me, "I want you to meet Nostradamus." And then she told me that, gosh, I don't have my notes in front of me. I wish I did. But it was something like the connection that they had was the most important part of the story, and that there was far more to this story that that we needed to know about and that we could learn about. And I think your research here is part of that. It's the beginning step of that. And I think, I mean, tell me if you agree. It seems to me that Dolores and Nostradamus from the other side of the veil are now possibly trying to tell us that we can do this too.
Yeah.
Can do what they did.
Yeah. Yeah. I completely agree that again, the stars have aligned and we are being told that that this is something that we can take it to the next level. This is something we can do too. It's punching a hole in time in order to speak directly. Absolutely. How phenomenal will that be?
It is. It's just, it's so exciting. And do you think, Tamara, I mean, you know, this is just conjecture and everything, but, I mean, is there something about the time that Dolores chose as, and again, this is me knowing nothing about astrology, is there something about the chosen time of her death that increases this message or this connection or this opening? Or do you know what I'm saying? Is there something about that that helps more of the communication, or am I just sort of reading into it?
No, I mean, I think that the death chart is a very significant chart, and absolutely, just like this deal with like the death chart between Nostradamus's death chart and Dolores's natal chart is also surprisingly, you know, well connected. So yes, the moment, because of how powerful that moment was for Dolores, like we saw connection after connection in her chart, which doesn't always happen in a death chart. You don't always see the death chart really connected so significantly to the birth chart in a person. You know, normally it's our family and friends that we see, you know, the connections with. But for her, her death chart just sings out that this was a moment chosen in time. So definitely taking a look at her death chart and really studying that death chart is going to give us some clues, I think, just like this Nostradamus thing. And maybe that's the next step, is that we need to take a look at what information we can glean from that and, you know, work with that. Like, you have a beautiful connection with Dolores with your moon and her Jupiter. So remember me talking about that Jupiter, the planet of wisdom. It's one of the most beautiful contacts in a chart is a moon Jupiter connection. It's like having a best friend forever. Uh-huh. You know, yeah. You know, when you meet somebody and you're like, oh, that person's going to be my best friend. You just know on some level that they're so connected to you. So You guys have a beautiful connection together. So, you know, we're all connected. There's all these ways that you can look at, you know, how we're connected and the strengths that we have with each other, even when they pass. Sometimes those connections get even stronger. So,
well, I'll only take a moment to say, first I want to say I believe we've got Marilyn again through a very creative connection.
Hello.
Hi, Marilyn. Hello, Marilyn.
Can you hear me?
Okay. Yes, we absolutely can. Tamara, you've given me the greatest gift in just the last few seconds. You know, I was so blessed to be able to spend quite a bit of significant time with Dolores in real life in Arkansas. But since her passing, I've had a more continuous connection with her and conversation and communication with her. And it's been growing steadily, both in sort of a meditative state and also a dream state. I'm getting lots of connections, lots of information. And what you just said about Moon and Jupiter, I can't even tell you. And I know that I asked you some questions about, you know, there's been some, what I believe in my heart and in my soul, I believe that there's been other communications that she has sent through to me, but not just to me, to many other people, to other practitioners, and even to clients and fans. She has been able to communicate with other people through the presence of birds, and in particular red cardinals and lately eagles. And I think it's another form of communication, and I have no idea if astrology, you know, talks about anything such as that, but I truly believe that what she always called herself a reporter, and she was very down home and earthy about that when she would say, I'm just a reporter, I'm a reporter of lost history. But I've come to think of her as the consummate communicator. And some of the things that you've said tonight just illustrate that and explain that so beautifully. And I wonder about these other ways of communicating too, through, you know, through the dream time, through animals, and through other things.
Yes, absolutely. It's all connected. It's all the language, the symbolic language, and interpretation of it it's an art. And as you know, I mean, that's what we're doing with QHHT as well, is, you know, looking at that symbolic language. But that language goes through many, many forms, not just, you know, the form of the heart astrology itself. But like you said, the dream, especially dream symbology, is a very, very important aspect of how we can gather more and more information and have access to more and more information.
Tamara, I'm just going to finish MJ's thought in the chat room, and then we'll let Marilyn weigh in since she's taken a little break. Where'd you go, Marilyn? Anyway.
I'm here.
So MJ was saying that what she was saying in that was written was that Dolores was most strategically located in reference to various pathways of time and various dimensions of time and how they interact. Plus, they were involved through her work in contact with souls with the type of mentality to handle the information and communicate. So, and she says there's so many beautiful correlations between, Tam, your information, your beautiful detailed information about Dolores' chart and what Dolores wrote in her book. So I know that there's many of us out there who are really appreciating this discovery, and it seems like maybe we've just scratched the surface. Marilyn, what do you have to say?
Yeah.
Well, I could go on because I'm really interested in the numerology of it. Not that I'm a numerologist, but the 18 showing up so many times, which breaks down to number 9. 9 is the number of completion. But also I wonder if that is the key that put in the lock through time, that has made this connection. I don't know. What do you think, Tam?
Well, actually, I'm just looking at Dolores' death chart itself, like by itself, so I can see it as the wheel. And Jupiter is at 18 degrees, which is that, that same number, and the nodes are at 18 degrees. So it is very interesting that, that number does show up so often in different, even in different forms, like 18 degrees Aries, 18 degrees Libra. So it's got all these scripts that it's carrying, but yet it's delivering the same message, absolutely, completion. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it seems to show up in, not just in very important places, I guess.
Yeah, yeah.
And it to show up over and over again. So, and like I say, not that I'm a numerologist, but I'm wondering if in the audience and amongst the practitioners, I'm sure there are people who are who study numerology that may be able to shed some light on this. It would be fabulous to hear from them.
Yeah. In her death chart, she has in the 12th house, which is another house that's very connected to QHHT. So if you guys are, budding astrologers out there and you're looking at your chart, not only would you look at the 8th house, we talked about the mysteries in the 8th house. The 12th house is actually like a direct connection to that which is greater than ourselves. Some might call it God or higher self or, there's many, many, many names we can call that. But it is that level of connection to the collective in the 12th house. Her sun, in her death chart, her death sun, Venus, Mercury, and the North Node all sit in that 12th house of, connection to the collective, to that which is greater. Very, very significant in the death chart. I was pretty amazed to see that as well. But, I'm amazed, but then I'm not. You expect it, right? So you're like, yeah, that makes complete and absolute sense. So it's all there in black and white and red and green and blue because I have mine in all colors.
Yeah. And you wonder, if she isn't sitting back there because I know, she's listening. It was Barbara Becker said she's having communication and said she's listening to all this. And I wonder if she's just sitting back and having a chuckle, wondering how long it was going to take us to see all this. And this kind of connects with your eagle too, Candace, because I'm thinking, the eagle sees the bigger picture, okay? We're looking at a birth chart and death chart, snapshots of the sky. How much bigger a picture can you get than that?
Yeah.
Right, and the birds in the sky. And, I've got this story too. This will end up being in my book, but years and years before I ever even met Dolores, I have this amazing story about, and it's a very long and beautiful story, but I ended up somehow miraculously raising two beautiful, from just being hatched, mind you, cardinals, and they ended up being male cardinals. And I never, ever, ever, as much as I love cardinals and I always thought it was nice and keen and sweet that, Dolores's, bird was a cardinal, I never connected them until I had another kind of communication from her not too long ago where she was telling me that it was like a precursor. And when, Tamara, when you were talking about the moon and the Jupiter and the best friends thing, those two birds were like flying around my head. And me raising these birds, that was 5 years before I ever even heard of Dolores Cannon. That was back, Marilyn, when you were first just reading her Convoluted Universe 2 book, which, by the way, I believe was the book that was sent to me in the mail by just an online friend, which is how I also was introduced to Dolores Cannon. Convoluted Universe 2. Mm-hmm.
And
I
got
to tell you.
For you then.
Oh, sorry.
Candace? Are you there, Candace?
I am.
Okay. I have a question for you. When did you read Convoluted 1?
I read it after Convoluted 2 because it
did
was
you?
Two
okay.
that yeah, it was two that showed up in my mailbox from the friend that led me to even be introduced to Dolores.
Well, I always thought it was strange that I read Convoluted 2 first, and then I read all her other books, but I didn't read Convoluted 1 until just this past summer, and I was blown away with the information in Convoluted 1, because I'm thinking, well, you know, after 5, how much more are we going to get? And I was just blown away by that book. So
I love that. I love that. And Tamara, I'm sorry, we were talking over you. What did you want to say?
That's okay. I wanted to tell you how significant the cardinal is. Dolores's canon, we look for foundational energy, and we do it by looking at the elements in her chart, and we go through it and we come up with a final element that the person is most connected to. And Dolores's is cardinal fire. So it's kind of funny that the cardinal and fire is red. So it's the cardinal, yeah. So anyways, I thought I would share that with you, that is her bird, absolutely. She is cardinal fire.
That's brilliant, Tamara, because I've thought about that. I haven't ever thought about that. And we're constantly making cardinal references, and we have cardinals in our rooms where we work, and it's always about the cardinal, and I never put two and two together there.
Yeah, it's her foundational energy. It's not because her sun is there. It's actually we go through a whole process of looking at all the planets, and there's a calculation that we make, and her foundational energy, Dolores's foundational energy, is cardinal fire, so it is the cardinal bird for sure. It's very
absolutely.
Nice. Yeah.
How incredibly wonderful is that? That's just icing on the cake on top of everything else that we've learned tonight. That is so brilliant and so beautiful.
Well, there you have it, guys. That's just to to wet your taste buds and get you interested in digging a little deeper into the astrology, the mystery of astrology, and how it might be able to help and get us a little deeper.
Yeah. Well, you've got me as a client coming up. I want to know more about my chart now for sure.
Absolutely.
I definitely know. Well, ladies, this has been such a joy and such a pleasure. I want to thank you so very much for joining me this Friday evening and telling everyone, your discoveries and your thoughts. And why don't we tell our listeners how they can find both of you in the future? Marilyn, how can people find you if they're looking for QHHT sessions in the Vancouver area?
Hey, I'm at bodysoulapothecary.com. I believe it's up on the screen, and you can find me there.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you so very much. And Tamara, where exactly are you located?
Yeah, actually, I am now in the east coast of Canada, so I'm actually in Nova Scotia, and I'm in Halifax, Dartmouth, which is a particular area of Nova Scotia. So you can get a hold of me either through my website, which is silverdisc.ca, or you could email me at tamara@silverdisc.ca and connect there.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much again, ladies.
You're very welcome. It was such a fun night.
It was
so much fun. It was so much fun. I thank you so much. So again, I'd like to remind those of you out there who are looking for a practitioner of Dolores' method, if you're not on either coast of Canada and you might want to find maybe someone else around the world, you can find them at DoloresCannonQHHT.com. That's DoloresCannonQHHT.com. newearthpractice.com, and you can find out more about me and my own practice of QHHT at newearthjourney.com. And I also have a little BBS radio show on every other Tuesday, and it's called New Earth Journey. And as we say good evening, I'm going to try to play our wonderful friend. There we go. Latita Teresa's flute music again as we close the show. And Latita is a composer and a musician and a performing artist, an author and a storyteller. She began her career as a flautist for the District of Columbia Youth Symphony Orchestra. Her dexterity and musical ability has known no bounds. She excels in the varying fields of pop, classical jazz, new age, and musical theater. Accordingly, she unites her original passions for classical, Renaissance, and Baroque music and the velvet rhythms of jazz. And you can find her at latita.com. Thank you so much, Latita, for allowing us to use your beautiful flute music for our show. And thank you so much for joining us, all of you, in the chat room, all our Facebook friends and N5D friends. And join us again next Friday evening where we're going to have an excellent show. We're going to talk baseball. Yes, we are. We're going to talk baseball with Lou Gehrig, there's an interesting story there, and look forward to next week's show with Quantum Healing with Candace. So thank you all, and good night.